today's class, and what we are going to study is some more ways the security of link layer can be compromised, right? So something that we have studied in the last class was as follows. We in the beginning studied security in layered architecture. The internet is essentially a layered architecture. So if there is a compromise in the lower layer, there is no way for higher levels to know about it. Okay. So it means that all layers have to be secure enough. If the wires are cut, okay, there is no way at the higher level layers to know about what has gone wrong, excepting that they will not get the data. Similarly, data link layer, if there is somebody who is doing mischief, like we have seen CAM overflow, then higher layers will not come to know what all is happening, excepting that they will not get the data. Okay. So we have also studied few link layer threats, and at the end we studied CAM overflow attack, right? Okay. So in this class we'll study DHCP attack, two type of DHCP attacks, in particular DHCP starvation attack and ROG DHCP server attack. Okay. We'll also study ARP provisioning attack, then VLAN attack. And if time permits, then we'll go into MAC address spoofing attack and spanning tree protocol attack. In this slide, I have mentioned all the references from where I have taken this material. Okay, all of you know what DHCP is. All of us are using DHCP. Okay. So at link layer, there are two important protocols that work that are based on broadcast mode. First, of course, is DHCP. If you don't have DHCP on your machine, then there's no way your machine or laptop will work. Okay. As soon as you boot your machine, first thing it does after booting it up is to use DHCP. Right? And then we have another protocol that uses a broadcast mechanism, that is ARP or address resolution protocol. Okay, so they are actually confined to single local area network. We discussed it, they rely on broadcast capability of the LAN. And this is how the diagram is. This what this diagram shows is essentially a local area network. Okay, so now let's assume Alice is sitting in a coffee shop. And what will she do first? As soon as she opens the laptop, she needs to have connectivity of her laptop. So she will look at the Wi-Fi, and then she, if she finds out that coffee shop offers some Wi-Fi, then she will connect to that. Okay, what is the next step? Note that Alice has just booted her laptop. Then of course she needs IP address, right? So after booting, she will know what is the laptop's MAC address. Okay, so laptop, big MAC address is built into NIC card, okay, network interface card. So MAC address or layer 2 address she knows, but she needs to know IP address, because if she has to communicate to anybody outside local area network, she will need IP address. Where will she get IP address from? So she needs help. Her laptop will shout, hey, anybody, what is the configuration I need to do to use? Okay, here her laptop will shout, hey, anybody, please help me. I need my configuration parameters. And one of the configuration parameters is IP address. All right, so what will happen? If Alice machine shouts, hey, please help me on the LAN, then somebody must be there to answer it back. And this is where DHCP server will come into picture. So DHCP server is connected somewhere here in the local area network, and then server will say, okay, I can help, right? So this is how she is going to get the IP address and few other parameters. Okay, so this is the first step. She sends a message called DHCP discover. Okay, please help me. And there may be one or more DHCP servers available in the LAN. And then that DHCP server will respond back, okay, I can help you. And this is the offer. Okay, in the offer, the DHCP server will give IP address to her and few other parameters, right? So you'll see what all. So offer message will contain, of course, IP address, the name of domain name server. Okay, then gateway router, and how long a client can have this parameters in use, right? So essentially a lease time. And it will also give netmask. Do you understand all these terminologies? IP address, all of us know, right? Then DNS server is domain name server. Because next step she will do is to Google or connect to some server. So if she types www.google.com, then her message should go to the server, Google server, right? So now, so it means that somebody should translate this domain name into IP address. Okay, that's the role of DNS server. Okay, and what is the role of gateway router? Suppose she has to send a message to Google, which is of course not in her local area network, then she, her message will go through a router, right? Okay, then she needs to know address of that router. Okay, how does she, next question is that how does she know that somebody, say www.google.com is not in the local area network? In order to know that you know, to machine she is trying to connect to, or a web server she is trying to connect to, is not in local area network, she has to use netmask. Okay, netmask gives actually the address of or IP kind of address of subnet she is in. Okay, so she applies the netmask to find out that server, web server, which is say google.com, is in the same subnet or not. If it is not, then she has to send the message through the gateway. All right, so now we have discussed everything, right, of IP address, DNS server, gateway router, and the last thing that we have not discussed is lease time. Because see, once IP address and other parameters are given to Alice, she can't hold it for lifetime. Okay, because these parameters are precious. I mean, if everyone keeps multiple IP addresses all the time and parameters all the time, then resources will be consumed heavily, and also it may pose a lot of other kinds of problems. Now she has everything she needs. Okay. However, the protocol is not done yet, right? Because she gets the offer from DHCP server or multiple DHCP server that we see, and she has to select one of the offers and respond back. So we'll see it in the next step. Slide shows how this communication, first two steps happen. First, Alice says the machine sends DHCP discover message. It goes over the network, and if there are multiple DHCP servers, both will receive it. In addition, because there's a broadcast message, and everyone in the net will receive it. Okay. Now what will happen is that both DHCP servers will respond back with the DHCP offer. And we have seen the DHCP offer will contain IP address, will contain netmask, will contain IP address of DNS server, will also contain default router's IP address. All right? Okay. So So this is what she will get. Okay, these are the four steps that we have discussed, right? Two steps we have discussed. And then third step is that she selects one of them and again broadcasts it to everyone. So she selects one of the DHCP server and the offer made by that DHCP server, and then sends it as in a broadcast message over the network. So what will happen is the DHCP server, which has offered these parameters, will do something. But all other DHCP servers who have also responded will know that she has not accepted their offer. And then they will, so it means that we can de-reserve those. And then what will happen when this message is received by a DHCP server which has sent the offer, that machine will respond back with DHCP ACK. Okay. So let's look at this. Once a client requests the offer, the client selects one of the offer and send it over local area network. So essentially it's broadcasting that everyone, including all plain machines, will receive it. And the DHCP server is supposed to, which has sent this offer, will now respond back with DHCP ACK. Okay, fine. So deal is over. And then I'm reserving these DHCP parameters like address, default gateway, netmask, etc. for you for some time. That's the least period of time. All right. That's all. That's all the protocol is. Now the two steps we have seen are broadcast. However, protocols do allow for all four steps being broadcast. It means we have seen that DHCP discover is broadcast and DHCP offer is unicast. It means that the offer that a server is making to Alice will go over Alice's MAC address because IP address is still not known. Okay. Similarly, when finally she decides on a particular DHCP offer, she will again broadcast it. Now this is the format of DHCP message. So we'll not go into it. Now, types of DHCP message are DHCP discover that we have seen, DHCP offer that we have already seen, then DHCP request that we have already seen, and then DHCP ACK. So these four messages we have seen are the important messages that protocol uses. And apart from that, there is DHCP NAC, which is negative acknowledgement from server to client. Okay. And then there are other three like DHCP decline. This message is client to server indicating that offered address is already in use. DHCP release, when a client requests the server, I don't need it, all these parameters, so I'm releasing them. Okay. And then DHCP inform. Okay. So, okay. Tell me where the threats are. Basically, remember one very simple thing, that whenever there is a broadcast, there is a problem. So everyone can listen to. And if there is a unicast, then we can also have some kind of problem if there is a man in the middle who is listening to it. Or somebody who is changing this parameter somehow. Okay. So now let's look at what broadcast is going to cause problems here. So there can be attacker. So Alice is broadcasting something, and there can be 2D sitting somewhere in between over LAN. And then 2D can always see all this communication that is happening, that 2D can hear what Alice is asking for, right? And 2D can also see, if it is in broadcast mode, what all offers are being made to her. 2D can also see when Alice is doing a DHCP request, which is again a broadcast message. Okay. Now, 2D, based on all this information, has enough opportunity to cause mischief. All right. So let's see how 2D will now do the mistake. Okay. So here is 2D. We call it Gobbler. Okay. And he wants to do mischief. Now, he wants to do denial of service. It means that nobody should be able to get any DHCP parameters or IP addresses. Okay, it means that he wants to take away everything that DHCP server has to offer. So what will he do is that he will request for all DHCP, you know, whatever DHCP parameters are possible, that we say that we can call it DHCP scope. So he knows possibly the scope. So what he can do is that he can change his MAC address and then send DHCP discover messages using new MAC addresses to DHCP server, and DHCP server will offer it and 2D will accept that. Okay, so essentially this will require 2D to change his machine's MAC address to get her a new offer, and then he will do it so many times that the whole scope is over. It means that he has grabbed all possible DHCP servers, whatever scope is. It means that all IP addresses which DHCP server has to offer and other parameters. Okay, so how do we prevent this kind of attack? Okay, we can prevent this kind of attack simply by making sure that the switch here can accept only certain number of MAC addresses for a specific task, right? So in the switch, in the port, if you say that only few number of machines can be connected or few MAC addresses can be used, then this gobbler is in trouble, because if machine say allows two or three say maximum number of MAC addresses attached to that port, then the gobbler can use only two or three. So this is one of the solutions. All right. So now let's move to the next slide. What else can be attacked? See, we have seen in the last attack, gobbler is trying to take away all possible parameters from a DHCP server. That's in the line. Other solution is that, can he act as a DHCP server? So that's interesting, right? I mean, so the gobbler or 2D can act as a DHCP server. Okay, so of course there will be DHCP servers in the network. So 2D has to be smarter to respond faster than those actual DHCP servers or genuine DHCP server. Okay, so as soon as Alice sends a request for discover, all 2D can do is that immediately offer something. Okay, and then Alice will always get offers from multiple machines. Usually she will select the one which that has come first. Okay, and then 2D has good chance of whatever he's sending being selected. Now, what is the interest of 2D here by working as a DHCP server? He is, of course, 2D is of course not a nice person. What is he getting? He can get so many things, because what he is going to offer is going to be malicious, right? I mean, say for example, he can offer a wrong DNS server address, or he can offer a wrong gateway server address, right? And that can help him. Okay, so let's see how. Okay, so what we have discussed earlier is again part of this slide. So 2D can send the following things. 2D can send wrong DNS server address, can send wrong default router address, wrong IP address and duplicate IP address. So these are the possible ways in which we can do DHCP snooping attack. Okay. So if you give, say, for example, fake gateway router, okay, and if then the client will use that gateway router address to send all outgoing messages. So essentially now 2D can force clients to send the messages through the router he wants to. There can be fake routers, okay, in the network, and then that is doing some mischief or malicious activity, and 2D can. Another attack that's possible is that, okay, so DHCP server or malicious DHCP server can give duplicate address. Okay, so if two of these machines work as a malicious DHCP server, possibly he will know what is an IP address that's already in use. And okay, so he may choose one of those IP addresses that are in use. Okay, maybe he wants to trouble somebody, or he wants to create denial of service to some particular IP address or particular machine that uses a particular IP address. Then he can simply offer that IP address, okay, to any request that comes in. Okay, and once there is there are two machines with same IP address, there is a conflict and communication stops. Okay, so in this way, by giving a duplicate IP address, 2D can do denial of service attack. What else he can do? Suppose he gives wrong DNS server's address. Okay. That is a malicious DNS server address. Then the client machine or Alice will try to connect to this DNS server and ask for, you know, what is the IP address corresponding to, say, gmail.com. Okay, that's here. Okay, so now this DNS server, being malicious, will return IP address of a server that is doing phishing, or that's just spoofing, that's malicious, but it'll pretend to be a Gmail server. Okay, and the Alice will go to that particular site and then type in user ID and password, and that server that's pretending to be gmail.com will steal all the credentials. Okay, so this is another very simple attack that's possible. Also, what are the countermeasures here? We can do only few things here. And first thing first is that we can determine whether traffic is coming from trusted parties or untrusted parties, right? So it means that in any enterprise network, we can define that on certain ports of switches or routers are machines that are connected. Those are trusted ones, right? So for example, a printer or a server, all these are called trusted parties, right? And then essentially we are defining ports that are trusted ports. And the all ports which are non-trusted, which are left open, we can disable them, right? So that's one solution. Okay. So essentially what we are trying to do is that we configure known DHCP server interfaces as trusted ones, known DHCP servers, right? So so it means that if 2D is trying to fake as a DHCP server, then he of course will be on untrusted port, and then the traffic from him with respect to DHCP that's a you know kind of offer message or a response message, all that will not be accepted. Okay, all right. And then another solution is the rate limit the number of DHCP messages per port. Okay, these two methods are shown in this diagram. First is that rate limiting the number of messages, DHCP request messages it will accept. And secondly is the dividing the number of ports into trusted and untrusted ports and allow DHCP server, the genuine DHCP server on trusted part or trusted port. And anything that comes on untrusted port, which is essentially to DHCP protocol, don't allow that. So to conclude about DHCP attack, remember if you use any broadcast protocol, then there is a risk. And the DHCP protocol usually consists of broadcast messages. So attacker here can see a lot of information and can either pose as a DHCP server or even as a client may want to grab all DHCP scope. And then we have also discussed essentially two ways of managing DHCP attacks. All right. So that's all about the DHCP attack and countermeasures. Okay, now let's move to the next part, which is ARP poisoning. All right, so we have discussed this. So first when Alice wakes up, she sends DHCP server, DHCP discover message. She gets an offer from, let's assume a DHCP server. Then she sends DHCP request to that particular, and then to everyone, and then the particular DHCP server responds back with DHCP ACK. This is simple, right? So what she gets is essentially IP address, net mask, IP address of DNS, and then default router's IP address. Okay, now let's assume that she wants to connect to, say, DNS server. And that, let's assume the DNS server is in the net or subnet. And she wants to find out what is IP address of, say, www.google.com. How can she reach to that particular DNS server? She just has its IP address. And remember that the messages will go over Ethernet. So she needs to know the MAC address or Ethernet address of that particular DNS server. So this is where ARP protocol will come into play. So Alice is here in this host, and then she has got the following. She has got the IP address, the netmask, the DNS domain name server IP address, and router. So she wants to use now this DNS server's IP address and want to communicate with the DNS server, which is here. Okay, but she has to do it over Ethernet, so she needs to know Ethernet address. For that, she will shout or broadcast a message, that's the ARP message, that please let me know the MAC address of a particular IP address, that is IP address of 1.2.3.156. Okay, this is what happens here. The host shouts, please let me know the MAC address of this particular IP address. So this will be received by all other machines will ignore it, and DNS server machine will respond back, okay, this is my Ethernet address. So that's the next step. Okay. So before that, we have assumed here that Alice has just rebooted her machine. And however, there is a possibility that DNS server MAC address and IP address mapping is already available in her laptop. Okay. So every machine or every laptop will have a table called ARP table, and that will have list of IP addresses, MAC addresses and time to live. Okay. Because this mapping is only for limited time. Because IP addresses, when they are reached out by DHCP server, the timeline or time limit to which it can be used is only limited. Okay, so actually she will get back the MAC address from the DNS server. So DNS server will say that MAC address is 58-23-D-DFA-20-B0. Okay, and she will put that result into ARP table. So next time if she has to again reach to google.com, then instead of doing ARP, she will just consult the ARP table. Okay, one of the mode. Okay, so gratuitous ARP works as follows. Okay, so instead of DNS server responding back in the previous example, any machine can also respond back. Okay, so gratuitous ARP. Okay, a machine, for example, here, the second machine says, I am 10.1.1.1 and MAC A. Okay, my MAC address is A, and then my IP address is this one. Okay, then that machine can broadcast it to all, and all other machines will record this in their ARP table. So all these things, all these networking protocols were designed based on total trust. It means that when internet was designed, it was not designed thinking that there can be malicious machines in the network. Is there any threat? Actually, what we are doing is we are trying to get simple mapping between IP address and MAC address. Okay. If 2D is sitting there, can 2D do some mischief here? IP address anyway is known to the client, but 2D can respond back with wrong MAC address. It works as follows. A wrong machine can spoof other machines. Fine, so let's look at one simple attack. It's called ARP spoofing attack. Suppose there is a communication between two machines, say I and J, and both are non-malicious machines. I mean, these are normal machines, right? And there is one adversary or 2D sitting here, okay? And it can send unsolicited, that is a gratuitous response. Okay, of IP address of J. Okay, it sends a reply, just plain reply. So IP address of J with some hardware address, say his own hardware address, right? So now all machines will cache this information into their ARP table. Okay, will now have when I is communicating with J over Ethernet, then it will send it to address which doesn't exist, or it may exist and it could be address of say 2D, right? Here it's very similar attack wherein so stop traffic from I to default router R, which means that I is communicating to outside world through a default router R, and if 2D wants to stop this communication, then he will say that IP address of R corresponds to some hardware address. Okay, so as a result of that, everyone will cache in that information into ARP table, and then instead of now I sending the data to R, it will send the data or packet to 2D, which is at A. Okay. And there are a number of ways to control it. Now, ARP watch is one of that feature. Okay. So it's essentially just nothing but look at what is the request and what is the reply and who is doing that. And then check against the database of IP address and hardware address. This is not a, and also nowadays switches are very intelligent and possibly do a lot of stuff inside to find out if somebody is sending wrong ARP response. Okay, you can, exercise for you, think how to make ARP operation secure. Can we use authentication of some type? So can there be some third party trust mechanism here or some certification or something?